Hello everybody and welcome back. This is Swati Gupta, Chartered Accountant. Today we are going to study International Financial Reporting Standard 15, or you can say Indian Accounting Standard 115. These both standards can be studied together because there are no much differences. There is one curve between both the standards. We'll discuss that in the end of this video definitely. The name of this video is Revenue from Contracts with Customers. Okay, I think we're good to start. Let's begin. To begin with, let's first understand the objective of this standard, when it is applicable, why it is applicable. Okay, so whenever we have to report any useful information about the revenue, we will be using this standard. Okay, we will report nature of the revenue, amount of revenue, timing, and the uncertainties relating to those revenue and their cash flows. Okay, these all are very important information that needs to be presented while applying this standard, or you can say the standard is required whenever you have to present this all in your financial statement. Next comes applicability. When this standard is applicable, okay, let's see. It is applicable on all sorts of contracts with customer. Okay, whether it is for steel or it is for salt, anything, entirely anything. If it is a contract with any customer, this standard can be applied. But it is not applicable for all those standards where specifically separately treatments are given in their respective standards. What are they? Firstly comes as lease contract. Okay, on lease contract, this standard is not applicable. On insurance contract, this standard is not applicable. On financial instruments, this standard is not applicable. On non-monetary exchange between the entities that have same business and that these are applying for same customers or potential customers. Okay, they are facilitating sale for same customers or the potential customers. If you are dealing with this any three, four sorts of contract, this standard, Ind AS 115 or you can say IFRS 15, this both standards are not applicable in these specific four situations. Okay, next happens principle of revenue recognition. These are like rules how to recognize revenue. Okay, we will deal with every single principle one by one in detail in this video itself, so stay here. Identify contracts with customer. Firstly, you have to identify contract with customer. You have to identify whether it is a contract with customer or not, whether it is a single contract or separately contracts. Okay, next comes is identify performance obligation in the contract. Okay, what is performance obligation? Wait, we'll deal with this in this video. Determine transaction price. Okay, the contract price, what will it be? Allocate transaction price to performance obligations and then recognize performance obligations revenue as and when the obligation is performed, is completed, is satisfied. As and when the performance obligation is satisfied, you can recognize revenue. See, it is a very basic concept. If you remember the matching concept that you have learned in 11th or 12th standard, okay, you will come to know it is very close to that. You can recognize your revenue only up to the amount, up to the proportion up to which you have supplied those services or goods. You promise some goods or services to be supplied in this contract. Okay, so as soon as you complete your obligations, you can recognize your revenue up to the proportion to which you have satisfied the performance obligation. Okay, I hope this is clear. Identifying contracts with customer. Now, what is contract? Contracts simply mean an agreement between two or more parties. An agreement between two or more parties that create enforceable rights or and obligations. Okay, that create rights that anybody can they can receive payment, they can claim their delivery, the promised goods and services. Okay, this is all is agreed in an agreement between two or more parties. This is simply a contract. Whenever it happens, it is considered as a contract. Now, as per the standard Ind AS 115 or IFRS 15, okay, that is 15. There are certain conditions mentioned. There are certain conditions mentioned on completion of which, on satisfaction of this, such agreement will be considered as contract. Okay, when it is, firstly, the parties of the contract have approved either in writing or in oral. Okay, either in writing or oral, the terms and conditions and the commit and they have committed to performance obligation. Okay, the parties that are two or more parties that are doing the contract, that are doing the agreement, have approved either in writing or in oral that they will be dealing with this and such will be the performance obligations and the commitments. Secondly, the identity has identified their rights. So both the parties have identified their rights. Thirdly, identified payment terms. What will be the payment term? It will be monthly, annually, lump sum, one time, whatever, in kind, cash, whatever it is. They have identified the payment terms. Next comes is, there should be a commercial substance. Okay, if you have two identical pens, supposedly, okay, these two identical pens say have same refill, they are of same cost, same brand, okay, their life is same. If you exchange those both, will there be any difference? Will it impact you anyhow? No, since those both pens were not at all different in their amount, in their nature, in their life, in their risk, okay, they were almost identical, then there is no commercial substance. There is commercial substance only and only when there is any sort of difference in respect of risk, nature, amount, or the life of it. Okay, so if there is risk, timing, and amount different, then there is commercial substance. So contract should have commercial substance. Contract should have commercial substance. Lastly comes is, it is probable that the entity will collect the consideration. Okay, so it is not like you have done a contract and the ability to pay is not fixed. Okay, it is very, very uncertain that your party that is going to pay consideration or not. Okay, there should be high probability of receiving the consideration that is agreed between both the parties. These are five conditions that are very, very important. They are very important that makes any agreement as a contract to be recognized. Okay, if these any of the condition is missing, then we cannot consider that agreement as a contract. This is core of this standard. Okay, to understand the whole standard, you need to understand these five conditions. If any doubt, please comment down below. Okay, or in case you need this PDF, these notes, then the link in description box is available. You can definitely check it out if you require it. You can download it and use it for your further reference. Next comes is identifying contracts with customer. If all the conditions of the contract that we discussed earlier in the slide are satisfied, then you do not need to reassess the contract. Okay, it will be reassessed only and only when the any significant change or circumstances has changed. Okay, other than this, if all the conditions were satisfied, okay, then no need of reassessment. Okay, and if not satisfied, then reassessment is required each and every year. Each and every year reassessment is required. If all the conditions are satisfied, no reassessment is required unless and until any significant change happens. Identifying contract with customer. Okay, contractual, it can be over a period of time. Okay, it can be over a period of time. It can be for a fixed time period. Okay, for a year, for 5 months, for 8 months. Okay, it can be for a fixed time period, or it can be automatically renewed. It can be a contract which can be automatically renewed, like every end of the year, like this. Okay, so these are three types by which the term of the contract can be laid out. Now, identify contract with customer. First comes terminal provision. Terminal means ending the contract. Okay, how can you end the contract? There should be any provision or conditions or some terms and condition laid down. Okay, so to end the provision, or you can say to end the contract, there comes terminal provision. There comes terminal provision. Now, if any party can terminate the contract, that is, both the parties have right to end the contract, then what happens? We have to see that whether the termination is without penalty or with penalty. If without penalty, no accounting needed. Whereas if it is with penalty, then accounting will be made. Next comes, if only one party has right to terminate the contract, that is, only one party has right to end the contract. Okay, so in this case, what happens? Accounting can be made only for the expected period during which such cancellation or such termination is not expected. For example, for a minimum term of, for example, 5 months, 7 months on completion of first floor, whatever the contract is. minimum time for which the contract cannot be cancelled, accounting will be done only for that period. Whereas if you come for another thing, another where contract can be terminated only after minimum fixed period. Okay, for example, before the expiry of 6 months, you cannot cancel the contract. If this condition, if this stipulation is added in the contract, then what happens? You have to do accounting only for those 6 months for which it is expected that the cancellation will not happen, such termination will not happen. Okay, you have to do accounting only for the certainty of period for which minimum period is certain that no ending, no termination of such contract will be done. I hope I'm clear. Other than this, one important condition comes as, if any penalty is there and it is equal to consideration, if in case any penalty is charged is laid down and it is equal to consideration. Okay, so this means that on cancelling also you will receive an equivalent amount of such consideration. So in this case, full amount will be recorded at the time of inception. Inception means at the starting. Full amount will be recorded at starting. Identifying contract with customer, there must be at least any condition fulfilled in order to combine contracts. Okay, single contract can be combined with other contracts if any of the following condition is satisfied. Okay, that is what single contract, if one or more conditions are satisfied. Condition 1, contracts should be negotiated as a package with a single commercial objective. Okay, it should be negotiated as a single package. Secondly, the amount of consideration to be paid in the contract depends on the price or performance of other contract. Okay, one contract's consideration will be received only when the other is also completed. Okay, if such kind of condition or stipulation is there, such kind of interdependency is there, then both the contracts can be combined and can be considered as one single contract, and thus accounting can be made as considering a single contract. Got it? Is it okay? In case of any doubt, please comment down and ask me. Okay, I'll be happy to answer. Last comes is, any goods or service promised in the contract are single performance obligation. The goods and services that are promised to be delivered are a part of single performance. What is performance obligation? We will deal with this a little later in this video itself. But if they are presented as a single performance obligation, then the whole contract, that the number of contracts will be taken as a, considered as a single contract. Got it? Next comes, contract modification. When will such be allowed? Will be okay. So first comes is such modification approved? We will go through the contract, the deal, the agreement that has been done between the parties, that is such modification approved. Okay, we'll see. Okay, while laying out the agreement, was modification criteria given, conditions given, any other terms were or conditions were laid out? If yes, then they are fulfilled and then only the modification is approved, otherwise not. Okay, it cannot be by willingness voluntary changes. Okay, it should be permitted by the contract between both the parties with mutual agreement. So is it approved? If no, then ignore. If approved, then you have to see if the goods and services are distinct. Distinct means different. If yes, then you can allow the modification as follows. You have to see if the present price changes represents what, the single standalone price or not. If yes, then approve it as a separate contract, record it as a separate contract. And if no, then the account contract modification will be done prospectively. That is from year onwards, from today onwards, from the date onwards. Okay. Next comes is some example. Example 1. A Limited enter into a contract to B Limited for construction of building up to 4 floor. Okay. At agreed consideration of Rs. 200 crore. This is one of the example to make these things clear. You have to see that whether the contract is approved or not. After construction of third floor, okay, in between, without completion, A Limited further changed the scope of work to construct 6th floor. Okay, so they have changed the scope of it and they have increased it to 6th floor, whereas it was previously for 4 floors. Additional price depends upon normal commercial terms. If it is approved, if it is as per the normal commercial terms, evaluate whether contract is approved or not. Such contract is approved because such things are given as a normal commercial substance and it does not represent it does not represent what? It does not represent price change. Okay, it does not represent any price change, standalone price change. Okay, other than this, example 2. A Limited entered into a contract to complete infrastructure work for 200 hours at the rate rupees 150 per hour. After working of 100 hours, okay, after completing 100 hours, additional after working, A Limited agreed to change scope of work and estimated labor increase of 50 hours more at the rate rupees 100. Evaluate. How it will be calculated? See, 200 hours at the rate 150 rupees. And then 50 hours at the rate rupees 100. Okay, this was stipulated. Now what happens? Since after 100 hours you have agreed and changed the scope. Before this, were you knowing any such change? Were you knowing any such modification? No. So for the first 100 hours for which you were completely unknown about the modification, you will record it at the previous rate itself. That is 100 hours into rupees 150, okay, as stipulated, 100 hours into 150, because out of this 200, 100 have already been completed. After this, after completion of 100 hours, these are first 100 hours, these are second 100 hours. After next 100 hours, you will charge by rupees 140, that is average of this. 250 hours, that is 35,000 divided by 250 hours. This equals to 140. This equals to 140. So this rate will be taken as average, weighted average, and here it will be used for the remaining hours after which modification has been done. For the year, for the hours that for which modification was done previously, the prior rate, the earlier rate, old rate will be applicable. I hope these examples are making it clear. These examples are included so as to make the revenue concept very clear. These are all helpful in making your interview questions, in cracking your exam questions. Okay. Example 3. A Limited agreed to provide service for rupees 3 lakh up to 3 years. Okay, 3 lakh for 3 years. To B Limited. At beginning of third year, like after completion of 2 years and beginning of third year. So before 2 years, were you knowing anything? No. Before completion of 2 years, you were not knowing anything. So you will normally be recording 3 by 3, that is 1 lakh per annum up to 2 years. In third year, in the start of the 3 year, there has been change in the scope. It has been extended to 6 years and additional price of rupees 2 lakh has been made. Okay, so price change has been done in the beginning of the third year. So up to 2 years, year 1 and year 2, you will normally record 3 lakhs divided by 3 years. Okay, in the third year, now the scope has been changed to 6 years. That is 3 years has been increased. And the amount 2 lakh has been increased. So you will do the remaining 1 lakh plus 2 lakh divided by remaining years. That is 4 years. Now 75,000 will be recorded in the year 3, 4, 5 and 6. In these years 75,000 per annum will be recorded. Now since this 2 lakh is not standalone price, okay, it is because due to extension price is not standalone. Since it is not standalone price, therefore it is recorded as separate. Different. It is recorded as separate. Next, let's see. A Limited enter into contract from customer to sell 500 units at the rate rupees 100 of product A in next 12 months. Okay, 500 units at the rate rupees 100 of product A in next 12 months. Now, after delivering 400 units, it was further asked that please deliver 300 units more at the rate rupees 90, since the price is standalone price. If it is standalone price, then it will be recorded separately. Next, summary. See, all the concepts, all the four examples have been summed up over here. If you are not clear before, you will get clearer over here. This is very important. Take a screenshot of it or download the PDF from the link, whatever. Write it down somewhere, but it is very helpful. It will really help you. contract modification approved. If it is, then separate accounting is required whenever there are goods and services are distinct. There are distinct goods and services plus the prices, the price increase represents standalone price. Price increase in represent standalone price. If it is distinct, the goods and services are distinct and the price is standalone price, then recording will be done separately as a separate accounting. Whereas combined accounting is done when cumulative catch-up adjustment, that is goods and services are not distinct and the transaction price relates to original contract without increase in contract terms. It is almost as the previous contract. Okay, it is not standalone price. Also, the goods are not distinct. Then it will be done as cumulative catch-up adjustment. Only adjustment will be done. Whereas prospective accounting year forward onwards will be done when the goods are not distinct and the part of obligation is satisfied and the part is unsatisfied and price is not standalone. If this remaining thing is done, remaining, okay, if some performance obligation is still pending, is not unsatisfied, a part of it is remaining, then you have to follow prospective accounting. Otherwise, you can follow cumulative catch-up accounting. Other than this, if goods are distinct, goods and services are distinct and price increase does represent standalone price, then it will be recorded as separate accounting. Identifying performance obligation. Performance obligation, whereas A Limited agreed to customer to build a water purification plant, A Limited is responsible for all aspects of plant, that is overall project management, engineering and services design, design services, site preparation, physical construction of plant, procurement of pumps and equipments and integration of all work. Identify performance obligation. Okay, this is what work 1, work 2, work 3, work 4, but you have to deliver what your entire satisfaction of performance obligation will be when you deliver a water purification plant. Okay, for this you might need tons of labor, tons of material, different things, designing, management, whatever is required cannot be classified separately because these all are done as one performance. You have to deliver what? You have to deliver a single commercial substance, that is water purification plant. So these all will be combined and given as a plant, handed over. So these all are considered as single performance obligation. I hope this is clear. Next, A Limited entered into contract with customer to provide broadband service. Okay, broadband service, voice call and a modem. Okay, your broadband voice call are different. Therefore, separate performance obligations are there. Whereas modem can be bought with some other entity, could have been collected and bought from any other vendor. So there are three performance obligations: broadband, voice call and modem. Three performance obligations. A Limited enter into contract with customer to build power plant. Entity is responsible for all this, project management, site clearance, installation, finishing, etc. Entity is also responsible for all maintenance up to 5 years. Okay, so there are two contracts. These are two separate performance obligations. One to deliver, build power plant. Okay, one to deliver power plant. And another to have 5 year maintenance contract. Okay, so here there are two performance obligations. Next comes is example 4. An entity enter into contract with customer to provide 5 year service at agreed consideration of rupees 1 crore. Okay, this is single contract, so it will be single performance obligation. Performance obligation is what? It is simply a promise to deliver goods or services. Simply, it is a promise to deliver any sort of goods or services. What can it be? Either good or service, bundle of goods and service, series of goods and service, whatever. They can be distinct, they can be same, whatever the condition is. If there is a promise to deliver any goods or service, then it will be considered as performance obligation. Only mere administration and management work is not separately considered as performance obligation. Administration work related to service is not treated as performance obligation. Next, distinct performance obligation, that is different performance obligation, will be considered when either customer can benefit either alone or with available resources. It can take separate benefit of it. It can take individual benefit of it without taking another contract, okay, if it can take standalone benefit of it or it is separately identifiable. The goods are different, separate, it can be identified separately. In such cases, the performance obligations are can be considered as separate, okay. In evaluating distinct performance obligations, you have to consider whether integration of service is there, modification or customization is there, significant, any interdependence or interrelation is there. If yes, then it will not be considered as distinct. If these are less, then it can be considered as distinct, that is different. Promise to transfer series of distinct goods and services. Okay, this is what continuous supply of goods. For example, you did a contract of 6 months and asked to deliver 10,000 units of any coal, steel, anything, okay, every month. This is what continuous supply of goods. Got it? When entity agree to provide customer series of distinct goods and services, then the series is treated as one performance obligation. Series is treated as one performance obligation. If customer has choice to terminate contract at each end of the year, okay, if you have done a contract for 5 years, this whole 5 year contract will be considered as one performance obligation. But whenever the customer has a right to end the contract each year, okay, it is on his own wish that he can renew such contract or end the contract on that year, okay. If it is there, then what happens? Then it will be considered as separate performance obligation each year. If customer has choice to terminate contract each year, each reporting period, then each completed year of service performance obligation are different. If 5 year contract is done and at end of each year customer has right to cancel it or not renew it, if such condition is there, if such option is there, then there will be 5 performance obligations. If 5 year contract is there and customer has no right to cancel such contract, it gets automatically renewed, then what happens? It will be considered as single performance obligation. Multiple element arrangement. What happens if they cannot be unbundled? They are naturally bundled. Naturally bundled. B-U-N-D-L-E-D. If they are naturally bundled, they cannot be separated. Multiple goods and services are bundled in such a way that even if their individual characteristics are different, but unbundling is not possible. If not possible, then it is single performance obligation. For example, machine and its compulsory installation. For example, if you bought an AC, can you install it yourself? No. Such installation is required by some experts. The person who delivers does not do the installation. The person who installs does not do the delivery. It may be possible. Okay. So whenever such two things are bundled together, but it cannot be separated, though they are very, very different. Delivery of good and the installation are different things, but are bundled in such a way that they cannot be separated. It will be considered as single performance obligation. Whereas if they are bundled and can be unbundled, okay, then they will be considered as separate performance obligation. Example, any combo offer, okay, any t-shirt plus shirt, t-shirt plus tie, whatever it is, okay, if they are bundled together and they can be sold separately, they can be easily unbundled, then they will be considered as separate performance obligation. It depends upon circumstances and the situation, what is the criteria. If they can be unbundled, then what happens? They will be considered as separate performance obligation. If they cannot be unbundled, they cannot be separated, then you have to consider it as single performance obligation. Customer option for additional goods and services. It can be in form of any discount, voucher, coupons, etc., or some any additional one-on-one benefit. It can be in both ways. You have to see for recording, for considering the performance obligation, you have to see if the additional thing is material or not. If it is material or not. What is material? If any transaction thing impacts the decision of the user, then it is material. If it does not impact the decision of the user, then it is immaterial. If it impacts the decision of the user, then it is material. So if it is material, if the additional things that are given is material, then consider it as separate performance obligation. If it does not impact the decision of the user, then you can consider it as a single performance obligation. PO over here means single performance obligation. Performance obligation. Okay. Next comes is, for example, A Limited provided customer discount coupon of ₹1,000 with product sold ₹10,000. In market, company does not offer any discount. How many PO are there in contract? There are two performance obligations, 1,000 and such 10,000. This 1,000 is very big amount, okay, and it is quite impacting the decision of the user. Then it will be considered as separate performance obligation. If contract can be terminated, then single performance obligation, it cannot be terminated. If it can be terminated, then separate performance obligation for each year. I gave you an example. If you have done an annual maintenance charges contract for 5 years and it cannot be terminated, then you have to consider it as one contract. If it can be terminated, then you have to consider it as separate performance obligation for each year. Next comes is consignment. Okay, what is consignment? You deliver your goods via using any agent, any delivery agent, transportation, any agency, courier, transportation, whatever it can be. Okay, so you take help and you deliver it to your customer. So the person who hands it over and gives you such supporting service is known as consignee. He does act on your behalf. This can be considered as an agent. Okay, it can be considered as an agent. And consignor can be considered as owner. So basically, owner is transferring the goods to customer but using services of any agent or consignee. Now what happens in this case, revenue is recognized when and only when the control is transferred. Very important, control is transferred. Goods are sold by consignee to the customer. Okay, both conditions are very important. Control is transferred and goods are sold by the consignee. Okay, you say the goods are sold over here and then consignee is creating an invoice and selling on his own name, okay, on his own conditions. And if he is acting on the behalf of consignment owner, consignor, then it will not be recognizing his revenue. Sales return is not treated as consignment because it is barely and it is fully on the part of the customer. It is not at the option of seller. Principal versus agent. Principal is a person who satisfies following conditions. Firstly, he has all the control. He is responsible for executing the control over its good and services. Okay, he has entire control. Secondly, he has risk. The inventory, if it get obsolete or it get upgraded, degraded, whatever happens. In any case, if he is bearing the risk, he is known as principal. If he is having control, he is known as principal. If he has right, or you can say discretion, to set price, he can charge his own amount, then he will be considered as principal. For being principal, there are three conditions. He should be the control. He should have control. He should have risk. He should be bearing risk. And thirdly, he should have all the rights, discretion to set price of such good and services. He should be in a capacity to charge price whatever he wants, whatever he finds it reasonable. Other than principal, the person is known as agent. Recognition. Principal will recognize the gross amount, whereas agent will recognize only the commission. As a revenue, principal will recognize the gross amount, whereas agent will recognize only the commission. Non-refundable upfront fees. Any advance amount given, any booking amount given, whatever it is. If it is related to admin work, then recognize such revenue when admin work is completed. If it is related to performance obligation, then recognize the revenue when performance obligation is satisfied. Okay, on completion only you can recognize the revenue. This is a core rule of this whole standard. Revenue will be recognized only and only when it is satisfied, against which it is received, like performance obligation, admin work, anything. Determination of transaction price. Transaction price is what? The charge that you are charging consideration for the contract, to which entity expected to be entitled in exchange for transferring promised goods or services, excluding amount collected on behalf of third party. It is simply the consideration for which, against which, the delivery of promised goods and services will be done. Determination, what will be done? It can be variable consideration. Variable means that will vary, that is not constant. Other than this, constant and estimation of variable consideration. What are the conditions, what are the constraints that can change due to which variable consideration can be changed. Okay. Any significant financing component, that is any, if you have taken it via loan or anything, you will be considering the interest portion, the inflation portion, whatever. Non-cash consideration, the asset thing, okay, if it is done in kind, then you will be doing fair valuation of it. And lastly, consideration payable to the customer. Variable consideration, it may vary. It may vary, like for example, any discount given, rebates, credits, price concession, incentive, performance bonus, anything, something like that. Other than this, it can be varied if entitlement to the consideration is contingent on occurrence or non-occurrence of any event. It is dependent on any event, or it is dependent on any sort of discount, rebates, or any other concession, incentive, then the consideration can vary. For example, A Limited enter into contract with customer to build a building at an agreed consideration of rupees 50 lakh. Plus performance bonus of 15% if building was ready for use in 2 years. See, such condition, such stipulation of 2 years is given over here. It is dependent on completion of the building in 2 years. It is dependent on any event. Then here, the consideration is what? Variable. It is not entirely fixed. If it was, for example, only 50 lakhs, then it would be fixed. If such, it has some specific conditions attached to it, which is dependent and it cannot be approximately estimated right now, then it will be considered as variable consideration. Determination of transaction price. It can be through expected value method or most likely. For example, you consider that, okay, most likely he will be paying 2 lakhs after 6 months. If it is most likely, you can take that amount. Otherwise, you can do weighted average via probability. For example, you are going to receive 50,000 first week, 60,000 second week, and 40,000 third week. The probability is 10%, the probability is 50%, the probability is 80%, whatever. You have to take out this probability and see what amount will you receive. Such amount will be recognized as revenue. This is expected value method. Next comes is refund liabilities. What are refund liabilities? For example, security deposits, like such thing. An entity shall recognize refundable consideration as liability in the books. This refundable consideration shall not be recognized as revenue. For example, the best example for it is security deposit. In schools, you must have deposited caution money. This is similar to that. Or you deposit rent and you deposit security deposit with it. Okay, these are always refundable. In maximum cases, if things are all right, all settled, no default is there, then such security deposit is maximum times refundable. Okay, if such security deposit is received in such a case and is refundable, it has a nature of refunding, then it will not be recognized as revenue. It will not be recognized as revenue right now. Okay, it will be recognized as liability in the balance sheet. In variable consideration estimation, what are the limiting factors? At times, it is highly susceptible to factor outside entity. Okay, we would not know, there is very uncertainty. For instance, there is a sudden lockdown. Can you predict that? No. At times, for this, according to this, there is variable consideration. Amount and timing. Similar type of items, experience, what was yet with the similar item, with the similar customer, what was your past experience, you can predict on the basis of that. Entity practice for estimation of range about, and consideration amount, the possible range. Okay, what are the possibilities, what are the probabilities of considering such range. Reassessment of variable consideration. Reassess the variable consideration at the end of each year. Change, if any, shall be considered immediately. It will be considered immediately. Okay, next comes sales return. Sales return, very, very important. Okay, you can refund it via giving cash. Okay, money back. Okay, other than this, you can give exchange. Okay, like you can replace the item that were given back. Okay, it can be done in two ways. If it is cash or money back, then it will be recognized exclusive of return. The sale will be recognized gross amount exclusive of return. Consideration for expected return is considered as refund liability. Other than this, expected return of product is inventory. whatever comes in back, then it will be added to inventory. At the end of each year, assessment must be made. Other than this, if it is exchanged, no need of accounting. One inventory went out and the other came back. If it is replaced, then no need of accounting. No treatment as sales return. In this case, increase revenue debit to refund liability, whereas decrease in return refund liability to revenue. Significant financial component. What is this? If you have taken anything on loan, then there comes interest item. Okay. If there is deferred revenue, it is very important in case of deferred revenue. DEFER. Deferred revenue. Okay. In this case, the amount that you must have received right now, okay, you will be receiving 6 months later, a year later. Okay. So in this case, there is opportunity loss. So to cover that, you add an amount that is known as interest. You add in financing component that is known as interest. Account interest separately for consideration received in advance and outstanding consideration by the customer. Interest is considered only and only when time value of money is very important. If it is material means impacting the decision of the user. If it is material, then consider time value and consider separately interest, otherwise not. Rate of interest will be taken as cost of capital. This is very important rule. This will be used in your exam questions as well. You do not consider interest when the amount has already been received. Consideration has already been received, but delivery is at the customer's choice. Okay, customer has told that, okay, please don't deliver right now. Please deliver it the next month. Okay, so this is the case. There you do not charge any interest. Other than this, consideration is variable. If it is variable, you don't know the amount. How can you charge interest? Other than this, the difference between promised consideration and cash selling price is due to factor other than interest. If it is due to any other factor, you cannot account it for the interest. Non-cash consideration is what? If you give asset in kind asset. So you have to do fair valuation. The fair valuation will be done according to Ind AS 113, or you can say IFRS 13. When to do the fair valuation? It will be said according to Ind AS 115. But how will it be done? The way it will be done is given in Ind AS 113. Okay, when to be done? It is given in the specific respective standard, that is Ind AS 115. How it will be done? It will be given in Ind AS 113. Customer provides goods and services. Material, equipment or labor provided considered as fair value. The fair value is included in transaction price. If the customer provides any material, labor, anything, okay, such fair valuation will be included in the transaction price. For example, any job work is there and somebody has given their own clothes and given, please dye this and do some block printing, anything. You have given it for some work and the material was provided, the labor was provided by them, by the customer itself. So you have to take the fair value of it. How to do the fair valuation? It will be done as per the Ind AS 113. The video for it is also available in both the languages, Hindi and English, on the standard. Separate playlist is mentioned. Both the links are given in the description box. You can definitely check it out. You can subscribe to the channel if you like the video. You can hit the like button. Let's see. Next, consideration payable to the customer. If distinct goods are there or no distinct goods are there. If no distinct goods and services, then reduce from the transaction price. Okay, similar goods are there, then reduce from the transaction price. If the distinct goods and services are given, okay, then you have to see whether it exceeds the fair value or not. If it exceeds the fair value, then excess amount reduction from the transaction price. If no, it does not exceed the fair value, then account for purchase of goods and services in similar manner as you have purchased from the supplier. Okay. Next comes allocation of transaction price on performance obligation. Okay. Same way, if you have to build two floors, for example, you have to build two floors and for 2 lakh rupees. On first floor, you will be charging 1 lakh. On second floor, you will be charging 1 lakh. So this is what, this is allocation of performance. This is allocation of the transaction price according to the performance obligation. Okay. So performance obligation single, no allocation needed. If more than one performance obligation is there, then if it is fixed, then use standalone method. If it is variable, then we will be using residual approach. Standalone method means transaction price into standalone price upon total standalone price. Let's see what is it. For example, there are three products, ABC. It has a total transaction price of 1,50,000. Now, the standalone selling prices are 80,000, 70,000, 50,000. The total is 2 lakh. Now, this 1,50,000 will be proportionated in 80 upon 2 lakh. This 1,50,000 is the transaction price. It will be allocated in 80,000 divided by 2 lakhs. I hope this is clear. This is what allocation of transaction price. What is transaction price? Here. In the ratio of standalone price upon total standalone price. Next comes residual approach. It is variable consideration. Then you can use total minus the allocated price. The remaining will be variable price. If residual value is appropriate, then allocate value is valid. Okay. If not, then reassessment is needed. Approach 1. Estimation of standalone price. How it will be done? Two ways. Very simple ways. First approach, market approach. See the market value. The net market value, what is happening. If I sell this in the market, what will be the price? It can be directly observable. But if it is not observable, if it is unobservable, then what happens? Selling price is equal to cost plus profit. That is cost plus profit margin. Allocation of variable consideration. If it is related to specific performance obligation, then allocate. Not related to specific performance obligation, then allocate on the basis of standalone price. Okay. Change in transaction price. In case the consideration that was allotted gets changed, then what happens? Change in transaction price is allocated to performance obligation in similar way as earlier. Standalone price must be same as earlier. If due to change in transaction price, contract is modified, then accounting is made in the way whether separate accounting is needed, prospective accounting is needed. This will be considered as per the modification terms. Okay. Next comes is performance obligation. Entity did, if it is had as a, has a control over asset or not. If it has transferred the control over the asset, then if it is over the period of time or at the point of time. If it is over the period of time, then POC method is used. Percentage of completion method. It is POC, percentage of completion method. Whereas at the point of time, completed contract. If the whole contract is satisfied, whole performance obligation is satisfied, then at that point of time, control is transferred. Otherwise, over the period of time, it is transferred well, as and when the performance obligation is completed as the percentage method is applied. Now what happens? Meaning of control of an asset. Control means direct use of remaining benefit in the asset like scrap value and all is with the owner. Ability to prevent others from the use. Okay, if you own this, you can restrict other people to enter from there. You can restrict other people to use it. You can restrict other people to have benefit from it. Okay, so this is what control's definition is there. How to obtain benefit? Either using the production or services, increase the value of others, settle liability, reduce expenses, selling or exchange of asset, pledging of asset. Pledging means when immovable property, when movable property is given as a security. Okay, then this is known as pledging of asset. For example, I have a very heavy, very precious gold jewelry and I keep it as a security to get any loan and all. That is known as pledging of asset, holding asset. Indicator of transfer of control, when legal title is transferred, that is ownership is transferred, assets are delivered, customer has significant risk and reward transferred, customer has accepted the asset, entity is right to get the payment for it. Okay, so any of the condition is met, these are the indicators that control of the asset has been transferred. Performance obligation satisfied at the point of time. If it is over the period of time or at the point of time. At the point of time, then you have to see, we'll consider this. Point number 6, over the period of time. It is over the period of time when following conditions, any of the following condition is satisfied. Customer is simultaneously receiving and consuming the benefit provided by the entity. The entity performance create or enhance an asset that the customer control an asset is created. That is WIP. Percentage of completion method. Entity performance does not create any asset alternative use to the entity, and entity has enforceable right of the payment for performance completed to the date. If any of the three conditions are satisfied, any of the three, then it is over the period of time and the revenue will be calculated as per percentage of completion. ओके. फॉर एग्जाम्पल यू बिल्ड अप अ बिल्डिंग ऑफ थ्री फ्लोर्स एंड ओनली वन फ्लोर इज कम्प्लीटेड, देन 33.33% ऑफ कम्प्लीशन इज देयर, देन यू कैन रिकॉग्नाइज रिवेन्यू अप टू 33.33%. गॉट इट? दिस इज समवेयर लाइक दिस. एंड इफ इट इज एट अ पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम, इफ इट इज एट पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम, then what happens, we'll consider this performance obligation at point of time, then recognize whole of the revenue as and when the performance obligation is satisfied. Okay, recognize whole of the revenue when the performance obligation is satisfied, completed. And in case of over the period of time, you can take either input method or output method. Input method is how much amount of effort you have given in. Effort, it is on end effort. How much amount of material, labor, promised hours, whatever you have put in, on the basis of that you can use input method or you can use output method. For example, three floors were asked and you have completed one floor, then you have to recognize 1/3 of the revenue. If you have promised 500 hours and you have completed 400 hours, then you have to recognize 4/5 of the revenue. This is input method and output method. For what? For over the point of time. Whereas, if it is at the point of time, then recognize whole revenue when the full performance obligation is satisfied. Next comes repurchase agreement. If it is forward, then repurchase asset, call option to repurchase asset, right? It has right to repurchase asset, put option, it has entity has obligation to repurchase asset. See, what is this? For example, you ask to build up a road. Okay, highway, anything, and you say you make it, you prepare it, and then I'll reimburse it. Or in other case, you make it, prepare it, and what you will do is I will not pay you, but instead you put up a toll plaza over it and collect the revenue via toll from the public. Anyways, the person who is building up is getting the consideration. Also, if government says okay, after 5 years the asset will be transferred to me, okay, after 5 years I'll be repurchasing it. If any such condition is done, then it is known as repurchase agreement. That means there is a stipulation, there is a condition that in the contract that they will repurchase the asset after selling it, okay, after any period of time or happening of any event. Put option means right to sell. If the interest amount, then if the repurchase price is greater than expected market price, then the difference is what? The interest amount, the finance amount. If repurchase price is equal to expected market price, then customer has significant economic incentive to exercise the right, then account it as lease. If it has no significant right economic benefit, then account it as sales return, sales with right to return. Economic benefit means, that means if it is a financial lease, then record it as a lease. If there is no significant economic benefit for him, then he can record it as a basic sale with return, right to return basis. Financial arrangement is what? If you organize a capital that is required via using loan, and the loan percentage is 15%. So the finance cost is 15%. This is financial arrangement. Recognize liability. The difference will be recorded as interest, and when option expired, de-recognize the liability and recognize revenue. Normal adjustment, when repurchase price is less than contract price, then recognize revenue immediately. Okay, recognize immediately. Otherwise, if it is greater than what, then interest amount is included in it, because the deferred revenue, here comes possibility of deferred revenue. If there is deferred revenue, so you might charge interest amount due to opportunity cost. Concession arrangement, this is same. Government gives a contract of 400 km road construction and it is constructed by JP Group. Now JP Group will be incurring cost and the ownership will be transferred to government after this. So repurchase contract is there or not. Accounting treatment, there can be both models. Either the government will reimburse the cost, okay, cost plus margin, or what it can do is, it can simply say that you collect the toll, you collect the consideration from by putting up the toll plaza up to next 5 years, you collect the consideration in form of toll from the public. Okay, so no, it is treated as intangible asset in this case, and in this case interest amount is included. Either government can reimburse the cost plus margin, Other than this, it can say, okay, I am not paying anything. You can collect it from the public via toll plaza. Okay, this is very famous arrangement. These are two kinds of treatment in case of service concession agreement. Now comes important, the difference between both the standards, IFRS 15 and Ind AS 115. Firstly, IFRS 15 is numbered in 100 plus series while we study Indian accounting standards, that is Ind AS. Okay, so therefore IFRS 15 is numbered as Ind AS 115. Now, penalty here will be included in consideration always. Whereas, penalty is included only and only when it is embedded in the contract. Embedded means included, or you can say mentioned, or you can say mentioned in the contract. If such penalty was stipulated, was the condition was put in the contract itself, then it will be included in the transaction price, otherwise not. Whereas IFRS 15 says always the penalty will be included in the transaction price in the consideration. Okay, I hope this is clear. You found it worth your time. In case if you like the video, please hit the like button, subscribe to the channel, hit the bell icon so that you are notified as and when I upload the videos. Also, I upload the same video in Hindi language. Separate playlist is available on the channel. I hope you like it. See you in the next video. Till then, take care, be safe, stay tuned.